we'll do this next presentation together, logging beyond the PDF or copy by reference. And I will sort of give an introduction of some of the more practical aspects, and Cameron will look from 20,000 feet above on some concepts, I hope so at least. And I want to start with sort of a schematic of the publishing workflow as we all know it, and there are different formats, and there are two big steps in between where you sort of break the document apart and put it together again, and that's a very painful and expensive process. And I would like to suggest that instead of building things on top of that and making it even more complicated, maybe more interesting, but definitely more complicated, to make it simpler, and to just go with one document format. And thinking about this, there are only two realistic formats you could use, XML and HTML, and I want to make an argument why I very much prefer to do this in HTML. And one of the interesting side effects of all this is not only easier and cheaper, but the submission and publication step is just arbitrary, so you can add many more steps in between where you want to do a preprint or you want to do something else. One reason for HTML is it's really big, and I'm coming here from the authoring side, so just tools that we have that we can use. I mean, they're just many, many, many of them, and that's definitely not true for XML. Looks different from a workflow perspective from a publisher, but for an author, I mean, I can edit HTML on all kinds of devices in all kinds of ways. And what something I just sort of learned in preparation for this workshop, but that for me is very important, HTML is not strict and doesn't have to be well-formed. So the problem with XML is that it's a very nice structured format, but to make the author create a document in that format, that can be very painful if you say, I want you to do this and that, and the structure has to be like this, and this is just something that is almost impossible to do. And then also HTML is exciting. We have seen a demo early on that HTML is no longer the boring format that we had in the 90s, but you can do everything with HTML from multimedia to applications and so forth. And of course there are many, many different tools that you can use as author for editing HTML. And one possible tool is WordPress, and I want to make the argument that the best tool is a tool that is not just used by the scholarly community, because then the number of users, developers, and so forth is just much, much bigger. In this case, this is just downloads from WordPress since last year, and so this is something that's used by a lot of people. I mean, just because we had the question yesterday, who has ever used WordPress in the audience? Okay, that's good. And something else about WordPress is, of course, that you can do plugins, something we had also in the discussion yesterday, the App Store for whatever. And there are, of course, thousands of WordPress plugins, and it's relatively easy to write a plugin for something that you need for scholarly publishing. So instead of writing an application, you just write a plugin for the part it's missing, and one area that I'm interested in that's definitely missing in WordPress is reference management. So I've wrote this little plugin that sort of searches the references you store in WordPress and inserts them in the text. And an interesting aspect of this environment is that it's really easy to do, and for example, we had a discussion yesterday about citation ontology, and I didn't quite make it, but I added at least the relationship there with 8 common ontologies, and I hope it shouldn't be more than a few days where you can just release it, and then you have, this is just hyperlinks, and you just use the rel tag for that, so then you have a relationship in there, and that's very different from coming to add that ontology later, but this is when you insert the link anyway. And I think that's the philosophy of HTML versus XML that not do everything 100% right, but have just enough structure that it's helping you. And another example would be this little plugin I wrote just for the WordPress user, where you just add a few extra fields, and affiliation is something that you don't have, and ORCID is something that will be useful. But just adding that in WordPress, when you then have a document that you create with that, you automatically have all the author information, affiliation, and author identifier in the future. So all these manuscripts you write, you don't have to do anything, and that's something that's useful, and that's not really an extra step for the author. And of course, WordPress is not the right environment for everything. This is just an example of using an Illustrator graphic, and this is taken from Flowing Data, a very nice blog about visualization. And I just took the Illustrator file, exported it HTML, imported in WordPress, so this is a WordPress blog post. And the interesting thing here is, of course, this is not a graphic, but HTML. So this is all something that is code and that you can change when it's still in the document. And then there are, of course, many other interesting things you can do with HTML5. Not expert on these things, so Peter, please, no questions on that. But this is a very nice interactive HTML5 molecule viewer. And that's just HTML, so you can embedded in your document, and it's not something that needs a different file format or that's separate in any way, but it's just there. And another example that is already there is just a WordPress plugin for Mendeley called Mendeley Related Research. So when you write a blog post, it uses the tags to find papers related to that. And that's, of course, something for blogs, but it's much more interesting if you look at this from a writing perspective. So when you write a manuscript, then Mendeley will suggest maybe you should read or cite these publications. And that's something that's in the writing environment that's helping you, and that's very different from any kind of tool that you have to use on top of that. And with that, thank you.
Okay, so, yep, not a problem. I'll take virtually no time. I really recommend that you look at what Martin's done. It's linked from the website, but it really demonstrates that what we can do with WordPress is actually really amazing, and it covers a lot of the experiments that have been done by major publishers and spending a lot of money can actually be done by one person in a day or so. The point I wanted to make, and it really arises out of Martin's talk, is that we can, using WordPress or similar tools, we can incorporate not pictures, not images, but the actual objects themselves, the actual data, the actual graphs, the actual links to the things that are going to help us link all this data up and build this graph and collect all these objects together. That's going to make the research communication actually something much more rich. And the problem is, how do we actually put this in the hands of authors and make sure they actually do the linking? So the real thing that I wanted to say is very simple. When the author is pulling together their communication, their paper, their lab notebook, whatever it is, the link to the real object that should be included has to be just one right click away at most. And that's actually all I really wanted to say, that there has to be a really simple way of bringing things in, copying by reference, not cutting and pasting. So it's got to be whatever we do to bring these objects in, the graphs, the data, the citations, the ontologies, it has to be easier than cutting and pasting.
That's why it didn't seem worth giving.
I was writing down in earnest what you were saying, and I didn't actually.
Any questions for this dynamic duo?
That's the first time something's happened. So, Cameron, I think you were arguing with yourself, actually, just there. Because one of the things you said, and I thought it was interesting, was you said the cool thing about what Martin was doing is that we can actually embed the data into the document. But then you said we shouldn't copy and paste, we should do by reference. So can you explain that?
Yeah, sorry. So what is very easy with WordPress or with a whole bunch of HTML, go to YouTube, youtube.com, pick the first video there, go to the bottom right-hand corner of the video, and there'll be a little thing saying embed. And you can embed the video on a web page, in a WordPress post, and it's trivial exercise. Imagine being able to embed the chemical, the sample, the graph, the data, and it just being drag and drop, or right click, or whatever it is. So by embed, I mean embed in the way that the Web 2.0 world works, that you grab a little bit of code at the moment. You basically have to grab a little bit of code and cut and paste it in, which is not ideal, but it's a real reference to the real stuff.
On this matter of embedding, I think there's room for us to talk about how you might set up standard ways of doing that. So there's all different websites have different ways of doing that, from YouTube to others. There's something called OEmbed, which lets you ask a server, I have a link to this chemical molecule, how do I embed it? So that leads me to saying that we should think beyond WordPress. So I agree we should use HTML, but I think WordPress does a number of things. It has an editor built into it, and it has some rudimentary content management, which may or may not be enough for all the complex things you want to do. But it would be really useful if we could break this out into discussions about the format and things like how you do links to supporting data as one discussion, so that we can then talk to the Drupal people and the SharePoint people and all the rest of them. Out there, you know, there's a lot of different tools. WordPress is just one of them there.
I completely agree. This WordPress is just one. So I think the important point was HTML, and use a tool that is used by a lot of people, is open source, and has an active developer community that you can then extend easily.
You first. You got a question?
It's actually a little bit more of a thanks than a question, because I have this like watch phrase I like to say, which is think like a vertex, and I think that's important for the PDF stuff, so I would love to talk to you more about that, and along with Peter Sefton, the stuff he was just saying. So.
Yes? All right. Last question. Gali, we'll have to do that.
I guess more of a clarification than a question. Are you suggesting WordPress as a publishing environment rather than an authoring tool? Because it probably doesn't support collaborative authoring very well, which is kind of key for writing publications.
I mean, a number of people have looked at or used WordPress in this context, and there are many different views on that. I personally see it as an authoring environment. I mean, the problem is... For a publisher, I mean, it's difficult for a publisher to say we only accept manuscripts written in WordPress. So I think one way to start this is to build a nice authoring environment that is sort of as nice as the ones we have, and go from there.
Okay, thanks very much, both.